Hello, boys and girls. If you are not subscribed to the channel, then you missed our reading of the paper Superdeterminism, A Guide to the Perplexed 2 weeks ago, offered by Sabine Hosenfelder, who is a physicist in Germany, also has a YouTube channel. This paper, as the title says, is about superdeterminism. It's about 20 pages, one of her many like papers available on archive, and comes together with another paper co-authored by Donandi, which sort of is the mathematical pendant to the first paper. So this paper discusses a model. As we will see, there is some math that elaborates on some points made in this essay-like text here. And we will reflect on these two papers a little bit and also give some context and related links. I want to start this video by reading out some juicy bits as well as the two abstracts, okay? So the abstract of the first 20-page essay-ish kind of paper reads, "Superdeterminism is presently the only known consistent description of nature that is local, deterministic, and can give rise to the observed correlations of quantum mechanics. I here want to explain what makes this approach promising and offer the reader some advice for how to avoid common pitfalls. In particular, I explain why superdeterminism is not a threat to science, is not necessarily fine-tuned, what the relevance of future input is, and what the open problems are." So I highlight here the word pitfalls. This is sort of a paper which talks about certain misconceptions because she argues very strongly in this paper for superdeterminism or studying models that fall in this realm. Superdeterminism here means, we will see it in some of the highlighted quotes whenever you see yellow here, that is me highlighting and it's not part of the paper. It relates to correlations of the agent who does measurement in quantum mechanics and what he is measuring, and in what sense new correlations are considered to go beyond what you typically do in the quantum mechanical context. This is discussed here in this paper. And then for reference, there are smaller particular models in the other paper, which sort of should highlight or support the sort of points she makes here. We will come back to the paper in a second, but let me read to you the juiciest section, the beginning of section 4. In my opinion, when I read this, the mental approach with which she approaches this kind of comes to light here. The section reads, "Superdeterminism is neither classical nor realist nor an interpretation of quantum mechanics. Superdeterministic theories are not classical in any meaningful sense of the word. They can and frequently do employ the mathematical apparatus of quantum theory, as with states of the system being vectors in Hilbert space and observables being defined by Hermitian operators acting on the states, some of which are non-commuting. Importantly, this means that superdeterministic theories can contain entangled states, the same way quantum mechanics does, and they also reproduce the uncertainty principle for conjugated variables. There is no need to change any of this because these features of quantum mechanics are unproblematic. The problematic part is the measurement update, which is what superdeterminism eliminates." I will, by the way, not here explain measurement problem and basic quantum mechanics, Schrödinger, Neumann equation, and so on. Sorry for that, but there is there's enough material on YouTube. Like, there's so many channels popping up or existing in the last year on YouTube that talk about quantum mechanics, and of course YouTube videos are not the only source to learn this. And also Hosenfeld herself does like to make videos in that direction. In fact, the author does videos on a quite broad spectrum, some of which are like seem like to be targeted at like school children or people considering studying physics, and some are much more like specific, like with these pet topics like foundations of quantum mechanics in the sense that we have it here, and some philosophical rejections, and other like more current topics. So this is a sort of educated pop science channel, I would say, which, however, I would also accuse of being clickbaity in times. There's some use of language that like ontological claims in her work and also in her writing that, I don't know, I would argue lead to confusion, like problematic questions like, does infinity exist or does time exist, and using language that, as we will see here in the next section, like she should actually be sort of, you know, be more careful or reject herself. I don't know how these two things go together. But okay, so let's see this. It gets better in this section here. So I have also repeatedly encountered physicists who either praise superdeterminism for being a realist interpretation of quantum mechanics or who belittle it for the same reason. As someone who is not realist themselves, I am offended by both positions. Superdeterminism is an approach to scientific modeling. We use it to describe observations, or at least we try to. Whether you believe that there is something called reality, which truly is this way or another, is irrelevant for scientific progress. Okay, so she says here she is not a realist. And you know, if you are interested in these sort of more metaphysical or philosophical stances, then I would suggest the... For example, the Plato Stanford Encyclopedia, which is a maintained website of unlike Wikipedia, articles written by individuals who quite nicely usually summarize some of these philosophical points. And there's many ways in which you can be a realist and non-realist. So it's a little bit dangerous to talk about these points, but I will agree that I'm also like. My personal perspective is a sort of there's turtles all the way down, and every generation will may or may not improve upon previous physics, and the next generation will also always have the chance. I don't think we ever end up with something which we could call true physical laws of nature, and in that sense, I don't think any mathematical structures we do will ever correspond to the physics, even if there's some operational performative value in having new theories which are exact in some sense. And for that reason, I agree. And so this is also the reason why a lot of the points being made in these articles are not for me. Like, I don't need that. I have no problem with the world being deterministic, if that makes sense. Or I have also... in the same fashion, no problem with the world being like having a probability as a deep down ontological reality, whatever that means. So I'm open for all of this, and so I'm thankful that there are some mathematical models attached and some discussions of like how to actually like correlate the worlds that we use with each other. So when she discussed this is fine-tuning and even just this word like superdeterminism, giving some definitions, even if definitions might be preliminary, is very valuable. And I don't need any of this convincing that she does in this paper, but it's fun to read, and certainly good rhetoric to have if somebody else thinks they know everything, and then you can point them to better definitions and arguments based on it. Okay, now comes the best part here. Realism is a philosophical stance. There is nothing in science itself that can tell you whether the mathematical structures in our models are real or whether they merely describe observations. It also doesn't matter. You could be a solipsist, and I would argue that you would still be better off with a superdeterministic model than with quantum mechanics, because in contrast to quantum mechanics, superdeterminism is internally consistent. So a bunch of this rhetoric in the paper is directed at the fact that in in various interpretations, in particular standard interpretations, Copenhagen interpretation, and so on. You have the wave function collapse or something to that effect, where at one step previously you have the continuous evolution of some density, probability density, and by Born's rule give chances to various outcomes, and then this is often seen as this ontic, like real, if I say ontic, I mean in the sense of being, ontology, this is a terminus also used in the paper, like giving the reality to the wave function. But then, despite the fact that this is supposedly, evolving in the Schrödinger equation sense in quantum mechanics, you then have this hard collapse that is difficult to get rid of, and you cannot model the non-linearity with the Schrödinger equation in this Hilbert space formalism. And so there's the measurement problem, and the she advocates here for something which is not quantum mechanics, but something which goes beyond that. Nevertheless, as we usually say, we want reconstructs these quantum mechanical measurements in some limit. Okay. Here I have to say, however, like I personally think that there's barely anybody who knows enough theory and experiment at the same time to be right about anything there. Like I'm pretty sure like all theoretical physicists know far too little. Pen on paper results. So usually they might hang on to various like tellings of experiments that supposedly happened and supposed outcomes. But the problem is, of course, that the description of the experiments needs some expressions of language that are like dependent on the theory. And so this is like a little bit of a devil circle, a vicious circle here. And so I'm actually skeptical of, physicists are generally overestimated or their knowledge. I will in this video try to be rather say nothing before I say something which is like on the nose wrong. Because I think we like the 100 years we have to live as physicists is not enough to actually become good at physics. So the best physicists are just as good as physicists can be, but I think there's like there should be another process of doing physics, because there's just too much on both sides. But okay, I'm getting too much into the sort of meta process of doing physics. Let's get back to the paper, shall we? So I will step through it and highlight some other sections that I found interesting and elaborate on the mathematical part in the other paper. But before we do that, let me step you through a bunch of other links and give you some context for Sabine Hosenfelder and her work. So there is, among other things, of course, the archive. If you know how to use it, then you can get a page with all the texts. Here's a little hint. If you just type in some author like Hosenfelder, then you have to watch out that you don't get just the results in some subsection, right? So I don't know, you might be searching for a name, and then the stupid archive search function gets you only in the combinatorics or the high energy physics section, and you actually don't see all the papers by the author. So that's a danger. I'm just telling you that. So if you search for a name, make sure that you don't have any subsection selected, which automatically happens. So this is a hack for me. So yeah, there is 80 papers. I mean, I suppose she publishes at least 20 years. Let's see. And if you look at the content, then you will see some pet topics. Okay, yeah, it seems like 2002 is the earliest here. Hosenfelder has some work on in the astronomy direction, but all theoretical physics, dark energy related topics, these sort of things. Then if you look at this archive, then you also find minimal length is, can you see this here on the right side, and you see wherever this minimal is mentioned in the title or in the description of the paper. So there's various texts that elaborate on restrictions on theories, if you add them and what the consequences are for quantum field theories and so on. I think these are also among her most cited papers, which is natural in the sense that probably what you, the older stuff gets is naturally often cited more often because it had longer time to be cited. Apart from, let's say, cosmological stuff and quantum field theory related stuff, high energy physics stuff, there is also the what we would call foundations, right? I mean, these words are not very precise in a sense. You could also say quantum field theories researching foundations. But what I mean here is these topics closer to interpretations of quantum mechanics, for example. And so there are these two papers that we have in this video, but there's also like previous work in that direction. So if you look at determinism, then we see here on the right-hand side, there's also previous texts. So for example, here is it's from 1-2 years ago, Rethinking Superdeterminism. There was also, there's also some discussion of like how superdeterminism relates to free will, and in the spirit of this first paper that we are going to discuss, like sort of distancing or separating these two issues and making some philosophical points. This is co-authored with a guy named Palmer, who we'll also see has a Wikipedia page, seemingly worked in physics for weather prediction. I didn't look too deep into it, but I think also like does some sort of set theory for going at physics, and has also like some views which apparently align with Rosenfelder's, you know, philosophical wishes, let's say. But even going deeper, she was also talking about superdeterministic theories as conspiracies already 6-7 years ago. There is also some YouTube videos, like she's relatively active also in the popular space. So there are some recent interviews where she partakes, maybe some Zoom calls, as is more popular now, that you can find that directly relates to the paper. So there is one presentation of her, as I will show you that, where she, 1-2 years after this paper, I think, explains these points, and apparently already there had some inclination towards like extending quantum mechanics in this super deterministic way, and proposes measurement schemes to distinguish the superdeterministic ones from standard quantum mechanics. Also, you know, I have not mentioned yet the word Bell's theorem, which sort of is one of like the points why people even consider superdeterminism, I suppose, because of course the Bell's theorem rules out, as they say, hidden variables, but there are some loopholes, and superdeterminism is one of them, right? And not aiming at elaborating on these sort of concepts here, but might be a pathway to get interested in this topic. So let's move on. I saw she also has a Wikipedia page, and I here saw that she wrote a thesis under the supervision of Greiner, who some of you may know because this man also wrote some books. And indeed, when I studied, I remember reading some of these books. They have a very nice hardcover format, small but thick books. And I remember liking the style. There were some stuffs in this text that I didn't found in other places. I explicitly remember reading about the Lagrangian formalism for the Schrödinger equation, actually, or the Lagrangian density from which you can derive in this functional calculus sense the Schrödinger equation. I saw this in this text, and I think barely ever saw it anywhere else. I might have even now and again, I extend Wikipedia articles, and I took some information I found there, like the fact that there is a Lagrangian density, and added it to the Wikipedia page. So this is my emotional tie to Greiner. You will find all these links, as always, in the box below. Let me close that. Okay, this is the other guy with which she wrote the Rethinking Superdeterminism piece, I think. And you can see what his research entails. Okay, I will not hold myself off too much here. The other author who worked also on this toy model thing, as you can see here, he has an Italian name, I suppose, Donandi. I might be confused, but so here you cannot, I didn't find the LinkedIn or Wikipedia page, but there's this Google Scholar text, and you can see in which direction this goes. Okay. As I said, there are some videos that also advocate for superdeterminism, like these papers do. There is this one discussion here where she gives a talk of 20-30 minutes or so, which basically is the same talking points as in the paper. The paper is more extensive. And this is one that goes back to this testing thing. I suppose this was around 2016 or so when she gave that talk, where she more particularly discusses an experiment which might be helpful for distinguishing those. She then also says at the end of the first paper here in the video we're discussing, in the text we're discussing in this video, that she then suggests doing less of the bell type experiments, but more experiments in the direction of Born's rule, which she also discusses in another paper. She has a sort of mathematical, I would say, paper out there where she derives quotes and quotes Born's rule from almost nothing. I mean, okay, you have to have some axioms somewhere. Interestingly, while Born's rule is generally liked, I also know physicists who want to actually reject that, sort of, because there's a lot of baggage that comes with standard interpretations, like, you know, to say the actual physical values are the eigenvalues and so on and so forth. I think there's some debate over that, stochastically speaking, and you know, the you have various sorts of uncertainty, and there's some tricky ways which you can like blend them together, there's people who give ontic or physical meaning to the expectation values themselves and not the eigenvalues of the underlying operators that we use to model them, blah blah blah. In any case, there's an advocacy for testing Born's rule, if I recall correctly, at the end of the paper. That's just what I want to point out. And as you see, if I Google that, if I YouTube that, I don't know if that's a verb, but if you search for what I search here, then you find these talks and also more interviews of her in that direction, I think. But then you already get to the videos she made herself on that. In particular, for example, there is some, I think from the videos I've seen, this is my favorite one, where she talks about the Bohm's pilot wave interpretation, because this is actually like more like specialized topic. I mean, Bohm's pilot wave and these sort of things are more exotic than other topics. And interestingly, she jumps back and forth between more like these sort of detailed studies of more exotic things, and then goes back to like school quantum mechanics. So if you see this, I definitely like more of this, like taking apart exotic ideas. So that's my request here. And then there's also music videos. So here's the Wikipedia link to Greiner, as you see, very prolific textbook writer. I'm not sure if I've looked at the classic mechanics stuff. I know him for quantum mechanics, and I think, I might get this wrong, but I think the guy worked in nuclear physics, and I think he has some more detailed books on these subjects. I mean, of course, there's many quantum field theory books, but maybe less so on this particular issues where he's an expert in. Okay, there's a blog that she has, I think, for a long time now. I know it because I saw this like 10 years ago at least. There's some discussion with John Bias and others in the comments, but I think at the moment this blog is mostly used as a transcription for the videos. This is, as I pointed out, this talk on this testing, which I sort of liked. I think there's Tooft somewhere asking a question at one point. Let me see. Whatever. Okay. Yeah, this is the testing paper with some these pictures that you also just saw in this on the blackboard in the video. But okay, this is just background. This is this is the paper on the with the talk on the same topic that we are just discussing now. I think this is 1.5 hours long because after her talk, other people also not only ask questions but also give also presentations. Good. Here now some related links. Okay, this is the Interpretations of Quantum Mechanics Wikipedia page. You might have heard of these words, these interpretations here. These are quite a many, like 10 or so, but they are not all. And I highlight this here because, as she emphasized, she wants the superdeterminism not understood as an interpretation of quantum mechanics, but as we would say here, it's a feature that interpretation can have. And she really wants to go beyond quantum mechanics in that sense, as you read in the polemic that I just read out from section 4, right? There's a superdeterminism Wikipedia article, but it's not long and not so informative. I think it mostly focuses on Bell's theorem, right? It even starts out exactly with Bell's theorem. It also mentions Tooft. He also has like some more out there interpretations or extensions of quantum mechanics, and is certainly knowledgeable, the guy. I think he is even more aggressive in arguing than Hosenfelder is, who is already like elbowing. He's also still writing a lot of papers. So if you like this direction, check him out on archive. In the paper, she draws, Hosenfelder draws associations or references to other approaches, and one she highlights is collapse theories. There's here a long-ish Wikipedia article, and there's also the Stanford EDU article on the topic, which isn't short either. Of course, I've referenced that, I think, before. Like, if you want to understand some of these philosophical positions, metaphysical, if you want, there's so many articles on Plato, Stanford, EDU that are worth reading. For example, you know, if you're interested in realism, non-realism, I certainly am, and there are some texts there. And as opposed to Wikipedia, they are written by usually one person, and that's a little bit more coherent and structured than Wikipedia articles are. Because Wikipedia articles, if you read a Wikipedia article, are probably hacked into it with some bullshit information, and you shouldn't believe it. Okay. Yeah, and by the way, like on Wikipedia, of course, like there's so much like information and variations, for example, of Schrödinger equation and Neumann equation. So much that goes much beyond what you will read in any unicourse, because of course your professor also knows so much, and the books you read, if they're the standard textbooks, they never cover all the fringe stuff that you find on Wikipedia, because there's surely this and that PhD students who works on this stuffs and then does their own Wikipedia article on the topic of interest. I certainly do. And to the extent that I will come back to quantum mechanic interpretations or extensions, I might link to more, but I keep it at a minimum here. We're already at half an hour anyway. So one thing relevant in the the text is the von Neumann equation, right? This sort of Schrödinger equation for the wave function squared, or the density operator, right? Like wave function cat, wave function bra, and looks like so. You have the time derivative, and then the derivative in the commutator sense with the time generating operator here, the Hamiltonian. And then I want to emphasize there is the Lindblad equations and Lindbladian, and there's this sort of equation which apart from, this is equation sort of with I h bar divided to the right side, and then you have this extra term, right? And I want to highlight how this looks like. Well, you have this like square in A. And then here, there's just some permutations of two A's and one row. Here are some factors. Okay, and so this thing exists, right? This is a little bit more standard quantum mechanical discussion, or this is like the whatever is possible in which you can generalize Schrödinger equation with some features preserved. And this is indeed then also what... as it was necessarily, the toy model pops up. So if we go back to the paper, this is the situation we have here in this toy model. I will discuss it here for the n equals 2 dimensional case. And so, so this is the model. And what is now different than in this model than quantum mechanics? Briefly, the following is the case. So here we have this psi vector in this space spanned by this two states 1, 2, we have some amplitudes, and we have some moment TP preparation time, and then standard evolution with h of this vector gives you this psi star, right? Okay, and then you hear some transition probability at this forwarded point in time, right? This is, if I get it right, the state, this state, whatever it describes in this theory, at measurement time, and then you have some transition probability, okay? This is like from the perspective of the state prepared here at this time, this is the future situation, and this will be the probability, the transition at the future time, okay? And what happens here in this model is the following. That let's start here at the bottom. We have this this alpha 2. This is what we had. This is this thing. I'm a little bit confused because of the I here and the 2 here. You have to read it yourself, of course, to get it right. Don't rely on me to summarize this thing. But the point is, this transition enters into these objects. It enters into this sigma 2. Sigma 2 enters into this L, and this L is part of the equation, right? That determines the evolution of this thing, right? So this is all like connected in this way, right? In this the psi depends on the evolution of, and this depends on h, but the evolution of this thing, it's not just this thing depending on h, but it has also these objects, and these depend on something that happens at the measurement time, right? again, have a look at it yourself if you want to get the details right. But the point is that these super deterministic situations have dependencies on values at measurement time, at least in the sense that these can all be correlated with each other. And that's sort of what breaks you out of the standard quantum mechanical framework. This is like a more extended mathematical space to play with and create models with. But nevertheless, this is like this example is tuned in such a way that when it comes to computing some transition probabilities in the end, then the situation is like designed in this way, in this toy model, that it follows that the probability of state evolution from one is exactly alpha one, this transition probability as it is in quantum mechanics, and so this is exactly Born's rule. So you have a situation where things are more interconnected. It looks like quantum mechanics, however, and you have this more parameters, and these are these hidden variables, and because of this interconnectedness, this is a loophole to Bell's theorem. So this could be a valid extension of the quantum mechanical situation, so this is the scenario that she wants also to be able to consider, like that people don't rule out looking at these sort of equations, okay, which are not like quantum mechanical on the nose. Okay, so this is the toy model text. I will not really discuss this paper so much, but let's, to wrap this up, skim through the other text. So the first half is like clarifying some words, let's say. The second half is like rejecting some standard rejections. And for example, here, she says, what she means by superdeterminism, right? She discusses that the free will was already discussed in this other paper with Palmer. And here, there is then more like classification and not like discussion of certain words, like what she means by ontic and epistemic and these sort of things. Of course, I'm just, you know, browsing through this to make this video not too long. But so just that you get a vibe of it. A lot of the paper is like emphasizing that just having correlations between the measurement setting, which relates, you know, to the agent measuring and the time evolution, why this is not such a big infringement anyway, why it's actually milder than one might think when one hears sort of this deterministic situation. Of course, you know, in a way, like if you have a classical theory, it's also deterministic and people don't complain about it too much. I mean, I guess people complain about it, historically speaking. But as I said before, I personally have no issue with either situation. I don't think it matters too much. I just want to do nice math and learn the models that are successful, I suppose. Then here, like, you did a discussion of a bunch of confusions that happen by the fact like that actually taking a very close look at Bell's theorem and what is actually required, and then coming to the insight, hey, at which point are correlations actually required for this theorem to hold, and so on and so forth, and thereby arguing that what we the way we extend in the superdeterministic framework quantum mechanics, again, it's not so intrusive after all, because actually the requirement is just that, or it's actually just that and not so restricted after all, if you actually look at the fine details. Okay, I could say a little bit more about that, but Better read the text yourself, I suppose. Okay. Okay, points I have mentioned before. Okay, here, I think this paper was released a little bit before the model paper came out, and so what you read here reflects very much the other paper. Okay, I've read this section. It's my favorite here. In particular, because like she's so blunt and calling quantum mechanics internally inconsistent. I like that. Pretty sure here the red tab, the emphasis is on the linearity of the Schrödinger equation and this non-linearity aspect of the collapse. Although it's a little bit rough, but why not? Why not? Okay, yeah, and then again, here, as I said, there are some sections here at the end that do convincing, and I don't need that. Like I'm okay with studying whatever you want. I have no philosophical problem with that. Okay, here again highlights the time of detection thing. Okay. More explanation if you're interested in sort of information aspects, signaling and so on. I will skip this here, but this is also part of the debunking of counterarguments if you want. Yeah, and then there's this part talking about fine-tuned, and there's a thoughtful discussion about the fact that this word fine-tuned is used in various ways, in various contexts, and with various meanings, and so she takes this a little bit apart, and there are some counter-arguments with regards to super-deterministic theories, what they would need and what they would not need, she has this convincing point that claims of fine-tuning really depend on the model, and she, in principle, like when she talks about this superdeterminism as is defined above with correlation between evolution and measurement setting at the time of measurement, then this is, you know, just as I did now, a common word description of sort of a situation that you want to permit being part of your models, and it's not a model in itself, like a model, in a mathematical model, as we have it in the second paper. And here, if I recall correctly, she sort of makes the point that to talk about fine-tuning, then you would need a model, like a mathematical model in the first place, and that's in superdeterminism not really what we had anyway, so it's sort of silly to argue that that the superdeterministic models would be necessarily fine-tuned. And then if you look at these sections here, in the other paper, I think there's even a section called fine-tuning or lack thereof. Sorry. Yeah, genau. So this is a point she comes back to in this paper as well. Okay, and then here in the end, two more sections I will read out. In the outlook, she says, the lack of experiment could be remedied with existing technological capacities, even in the absence of a fully-fledged theory, if the quantum foundations community would overcome their obsession with bell-type tests. Bell-type tests will never allow to tell superdeterminism apart from quantum mechanics. Instead, we will need to look for deviations from Born's rule in small and closed systems. And finally, she references this toy model paper. Yeah, I want to also emphasize, I showed you some of the intricacies of this sort of evolution equation and these new dependencies. Here, she emphasizes that this is to be understood as an effective limit of another theory, of a stronger mathematical theory, I suppose. And only in the effective limit, you know, if you know what an effective theory is, would it look like would, it, I think, look so plain as it does in the other paper. Sorry. Drinking soda here. What prevents us from making progress here is simply that we haven't made enough effort. I love this. Because superdeterminism has historically been stigmatized as unscientific, pretty much no work went into formulating a useful theory for it. So at present, all we have are toy models. I sincerely hope that these notes will serve to encourage some readers to explore the benefits of giving up statistical independence and make a headway on developing a theory for superdeterminism. So, so in wrapping up, I think what really helps is like reading the first half of this paper, which is about the statistical parts, which I consider at the hardest in a sense, to your wrap your head around and have some good definitions. And indeed, there are some definitions given that one can work by. Right, so here, statistical independence means that a degree of freedom of a spatially separated system can be considered uncorrelated. And this is the things that are given up. So all in all, I liked that paper. The writing style a little bit too casual from my taste, but I mean, that doesn't matter too much. It's otherwise nicely written. This is a sort of essay paper which gives a bunch of like better definitions to words you usually hear spoken but are never really quite elaborated on, and it's very important that people sit down and take the time and take claims apart, and then there's some convincing done, which I don't need as I argued for, because I like, you know, everything goes with me in this direction. If you want to study this and that math, so that's okay. I think I will leave it at that. I hope this was interesting. I went a little bit too casual and too over time, as it usually happens. Please subscribe to the channel, and what's more, make suggestions for future paper readings. Okay, that's your job. Post in the comments below what you want to talk about. It should be papers that. This sort of paper was nice to read, because while it requires you to have seen quantum mechanics before, it's not extremely specialized. It's not specialized math or anything. It can be read by somebody who has basic quantum mechanics inclinations and knowledge. And if I, as I go and do reading streams and discuss papers, it helps if people have an angle to the things, and it's not too specialized. Otherwise, you don't get like several people together with which you can discuss these things. So that's it, folks. I wish you a good night, okay?